Reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. And it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This census first took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, every one to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child. So it was that while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. That verse 7 sums up the experience of Jesus' life on earth. Let's read it again. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Well, last week saw another first for me in pastoral ministry, so let me tell you about it. It occurred during some routine visitation, preparing to call on a member of this church who is institutionalized. I, of course, first called the receptionist at the institution, as I ordinarily do, to find out current regulations regarding clergy visitation. Well, on the phone, I understood the receptionist to say that a mask would be required of me, my temperature would be taken at the door upon arrival, and that's it. Well, that's standard these days, no surprise there, especially since I've been visiting this same facility for several years now. However, when I arrived, the regular receptionist desk was vacant, and I was met actually, I was confronted by a female worker in the entry who curtly demanded the purpose of my visit, even though I had a prominent clergy identification badge showing, and that could be easily read by 6 or 7 feet away. She said, "You have to go back out." And she pointed to the area between the two sets of double doors, and I complied, and in a moment or so, the same woman reappeared with a clipboard, and she told me to fill out these two forms, and then she disappeared again. So I sat down on a bench in that breezeway there, and I began to fill out the forms when I heard a voice say, "You too, huh?" And apparently it was another clergyman from a nearby area. So we exchanged some pleasantries while I completed the forms, and then he was admitted. Then the same woman reappeared, took the forms from me, and disappeared again. And then she reappeared, and she walked up to me with something in her hands that looked like maybe a Band-Aid or something, and she tore it open, and she pulled out a Q-tip, and she shoved it up my nostril. And then she pushed it in the other nostril and moved it around, and then it occurred to me, my, I must be being tested for COVID-19. Well, that part of the entrance exam over, I was now instructed to wait in the same space for 15 or 20 minutes more, presumably for the results, after which I was finally permitted to visit our beloved church member, who, when I arrived, had absolutely no idea who I was. Nevertheless, as the pastor, I delivered a small Christmas gift and read scripture, had prayer, and then departed. Well, suffice it to say that while declaring ourselves properly vaccinated and virus-free on paper is sufficient in some spaces and places we go these days, it's simply not enough for other places and spaces. In these days of sanitary consciousness, we're being reminded that one must be declared clean by whatever procedures may be deemed necessary by the powers that be. And I don't have to tell you that this sort of imposition, as we know from news reports all over the United States, has not gained universal acceptance, even though most probably would agree it's for our own good. In this Advent Christmas season, we've been looking at some great carols of the Christian faith in an effort to see some of the deeper underlying spiritual truths which they present regarding the Lord's incarnation. Today we come to the carol entitled, Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne. And yes, it's written in Elizabethan English, which is taken from the 1600s. That makes it pretty difficult. It's found on page 116 of the Red Hymnal. It was written by Emily Elliott, the niece of Charlotte Elliott, who you should know is the author of the hymn, Just As I Am, Without One Plea, But That Thy Blood Was Shed For Me. There is one specific word in the carol. It's a conjunction. That's the part of speech it is, that is key to understanding the entire theme of this carol. One three-letter word. It occurs as the first word in the second stanza, and it's the word but, B-U-T. That word sets off four different paradoxes or incongruities that mark our Lord's earthly experience given his exalted and eternal identity. In short, the author of our carol clearly speaks of who Jesus was at his first coming and the honor and the dignity he deserved, but then it shows the humiliation and the insult he actually received at his coming. Now, Luke the evangelist encapsulates the rude welcome Jesus received at his birth by telling us that, first of all, the Roman government mandated that everyone go back to the city of their nativity and register for the census. And so that meant that Joseph and Mary had to make the 90-mile trip from Nazareth to Bethlehem with Mary basically on the verge of labor pains. It was a distance that probably took 5 days. It was while our Lord's earthly parents were there in Bethlehem on this unenviable mission of registering for the census in order to be taxed by a repressive foreign government that Mary's labor pains became acute and she delivered a firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, that is strips of cloth to keep him warm, and then laid him in a cattle trough. That's what a manger is. It's where the animals come to eat. And why did she do all that? Luke says, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now that statement, because there was no room for them in the inn, is not just a prophecy of his earthly experience, but also an indictment against the rest of us, against the world, which failed to recognize who Jesus was and to give him his due. So let's consider how the carol amplifies that one statement, that one phrase that Luke uses to describe Jesus' life. Notice in stanza 1, thou didst leave thy throne and thy kingly crown when thou camest to earth for me. Now that speaks of Jesus' deity. Don't let the Jehovah Witnesses, don't let the Mormons tell you that Jesus was not God. Jesus was God in flesh. The Bible says all the fullness of the Godhead dwelt in him bodily. Bodily. Philippians 2:6 says, who being in very nature God, did not consider that equality with God something to be used for his own advantage, something to be grasped at and held to. No, he didn't cling to it. He let it go, and then he stepped down from glory to this earth. Then the carol presents the paradox in the very next statement. But in Bethlehem's home was there found no room for thy holy nativity. Now the world gave him a stable, dirty, smelly, stinking, when they should have been giving him the best room in the inn. And some ask the question, why in the world, since Jesus told the church to go into all the world and preach the gospel, and we have radio and we have television and we have the internet and we have Bibles made in virtually every translation so that even a child in kindergarten can understand them, why in the world then does it seem that Christianity is making such poor progress in the world? Well, the answer is this. It's not the world. It's because the church gives him no room. Instead of prayer, instead of Bible study, instead of fervent worship, churches adopt and adapt the world's methods and they pull them into the church and think by doing that they're going to attract people. Well, they may attract people, but their souls will go to hell. The Bible doesn't say to attract people. Jesus didn't give that command. He said, go and make disciples. He didn't say make converts. And what we have in the church today are three things: stagecraft, churchcraft, and priestcraft. The word craft meaning a clever manipulation of these things, rather than a reliance of the power from on high. That means Hollywood-style buildings with no sanctuary, no cross, but prominent TV screens. It means music in the church that mimics the world. It means worldly attractions to satisfy our bodily cravings, such as cafes, gymnasiums, and large screen TVs, and then preachers. Oh, preachers, yes, but preachers who do this. They tickle the ear and make people laugh. Why is the church making such little progress, you say? Jesus gets no room. He gets no room in the heart by people who call themselves Christian. Now, Jesus is hustled out the door by material pursuits, carnal thinking, a reliance upon man's intellect, because nobody is spending any time in his word. To be clear, nobody is saved by buying a Bible they don't use, and nobody is saved by reading a Bible that they have no intention of obeying. That's why the psalmist said, Psalm 119:11, thy word have I did what? Hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. There has to be a place, there has to be a time for Jesus. When you shut the doors and you shut the world out and you say, Lord, this is your time. Otherwise, you're just engaging in craft. And the word craft and craftiness suggests deceit. Stagecraft, churchcraft, priestcraft. No room. No room in Bethlehem. No room in people's hearts. No wonder we're not making progress. Next, we come to the second verse of the carol, which speaks of heaven arches rang when the angels sang, proclaiming the royal decree. And the paradox of the jubilation in heaven is introduced by the second but. But of lowly birth didst thou come to earth, and in great humility. Well, there were no celebrations in the manger, only the putrid smell of hay and cow manure. So far as we know, not even any people until the shepherds arrived. It was dark, it was clammy, it was unsanitary, nothing like today's state-of-the-art neonatal units in the hospitals downtown, where lullabies are piped in to the neonatal unit by the sound system. Just animal sounds, gurgling and burping and coughing and gagging and eating. That's what was heard. Don't you get tired of people who come to church looking for entertainment? Running around from church to church, church hopping. For some kind of high. You know, we talk about people smoking marijuana. There are many people going around to churches hoping that some kind of fumes of religious marijuana will transport them out of reality into the imaginary. That's not what Jesus said. Jesus said, you're to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And Peter says, gird up the loins of your mind, hope to the end for the grace that is to be given to you at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Don't put your mind in neutral. Now's the time to use your mind. But many people don't want to do it. They're chasing some imaginary high. But of lowly birth didst thou come to earth, and in great humility. Well, the next paradoxical statement is verse 3, which talks about the foxes and birds. The foxes found rest, and the birds their nest in the shade of the forest tree. But the couch was his sod, O thou Son of God, in the deserts of Galilee. You know, as you look at the Bible and as you read about Jesus' life and you read about John the Baptist's life, one thing stands out. These people were out alone in nature a good part of their lives. John the Baptist ate locusts and wild honey. Here's a reference to something Jesus said in response to a teacher, a prominent teacher of the law, who came to Jesus professing that he would follow Jesus wherever. And Jesus said, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay. Do you really want to follow me? I don't have a motel booked at the Holiday Inn for tonight. I have no place to stay. Do you really want to follow me? Imagine the town of Mayfield, Kentucky, where people spent the last two or three nights in the city hall because the entire town was reduced to a rubble pile by what might be the longest tornado in U.S. history. We like our homes. Especially after seeing the weather here yesterday. But even animals have their holes, dens, and nests. But Paul told the Corinthians, you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might be made rich. Jesus had the protection of the Father's house in heaven. He didn't have to worry about COVID-19. He didn't have to worry about inflation. There was complete security. But he left it all to come to this world in order to die for sinners. I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me? Well, the focus of the next verse is, thou camest, O Lord, with the living word, that should set thy people free. But with mocking scorn and with crown of thorn, they bore thee to Calvary. That's the paradox. But with mocking scorn and with crown of thorn, they bore thee to Calvary. Certainly the cross was a bloody spectacle. It also was unsanitary. The nails were driven in his hands and in his feet. A crown of thorns was placed on his head, and that after his back had been opened by a whip. And finally, eventually, a spear was thrust in his side. Surely, you say, this was the ultimate expression of Luke's phrase, because there was no room for him in the end. No, it's not. Not even that was the ultimate scene or drama of rejection, hardship, and deprivation. In review, it wasn't merely being born in a stable and laid in a feeding trough. It wasn't Herod's massacre of the innocents when he was inquiring of him by the wise men. It wasn't even his parents misunderstanding him when he was among the elders in the temple and they were looking for him and he said, how is it that you didn't know that I'd be about my father's business? It wasn't even his brothers who said, if you really want to be known by the world, go up to the feast now. They didn't believe him. It wasn't even the growing doubt of John the Baptist who sent a message via his disciples to Jesus saying, are you the one that's supposed to come or should we really be looking for somebody else? It wasn't even the 12 disciples who time and time again, Jesus said, the Son of Man will be going up to Jerusalem and he'll be rejected of the Jews and handed over to the Gentiles who will crucify him, but the third day he will rise. Not even that. Of all that, and it's certainly the prophetic fulfillment of no room at the inn, but that's not the greatest paradox. The greatest paradox of Jesus finding no room is when he finds no room in your heart. That is to say, my heart is so foul and unclean, it's despicable. It's absolutely despicable. It would be like me going to your house after you had had a very busy week and you said, please don't come in, Pastor. The house is a mess. Maybe later. Can't be later. Jesus is being delivered right now. Mary can't wait any longer. Well, some say, I just don't feel worthy. I don't feel worthy, and that's why I can't open the door of my heart. I don't have any room. It's just that I don't feel acceptable. Jesus never asked about your feelings, and he never asked about your worthiness. If that were the criteria, no one of us would receive Jesus into our heart, because God had already told Jeremiah hundreds of years before, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can possibly understand how bad it is? Oh, but some might say, my heart is wicked. It's full of devils. It's full of wild beasts. I can't control my wild thoughts, my desires, my lust, my pride, my envy, my malice, my gossip, my bitterness of spirit, my critical spirit. I can't control that. Well, the stall where Jesus was born had animals in it, and even though those animals were domesticated, probably, and not wild animals, they were still animals. And they were still wild in the sense that if you got between them and the feeding trough, they'd trample you. You say, but I can't seem to forget my past. And I can't forgive myself for something I've done. Of course you can. I can. That's not the point. The point is that Jesus can forgive. And Jesus can forget. He said from the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And the psalmist picked up on that and said, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. He didn't say from the north to the south, because that's a measurable distance. But from the east to the west, you can't measure. And maybe you're just feeling empty with nothing to set before Jesus if you invited him into the room of your heart. I mean, there's really nothing there. You're empty. Then it's all the more reason that you should let Jesus in. It's all the more you should offer him to come in and bring you the grace and the truth and the righteousness and the purity, because that's the very reason that he came and died. But now a righteousness apart from the law is revealed. Even the righteousness of God, which is what? By faith of Jesus Christ. It's not faith in you, and it's not faith in the pastor, and it's not faith in the church, and it's not faith in religious organization. Faith in Christ. Here's the Son of God, made flesh. And what do you say? What's the proper response? The proper response is, Lord Jesus, in light of all the filth, in light of all my vileness, in light of all my unworthy and unfit condition, in spite of that, the things that I can't straighten out, the things that I cannot put in order in my life, I still invite you. Oh, come to my heart, Lord Jesus. There is room in my heart for you. Somebody put it this way. The reason we can do that is this. They borrowed a bed to lay his head when Christ the Lord came down. They borrowed the ass in the mountain pass for him to ride to town. But the crown that he wore and the cross that he bore were his own. The cross was his own. He borrowed the bread when the crowd he fed on the grassy mountainside. He borrowed the dish of broken fish with which he satisfied. But the crown that he wore and the cross that he bore were his own. The cross was his own. He borrowed the ship in which to sit to teach the multitude. He borrowed a nest in which to rest. He had never a home so rude. But the crown that he wore and the cross that he bore were his own. The cross was his own. He borrowed a room on his way to the tomb, the Passover lamb to eat. They borrowed a cave, for him a grave. They borrowed a winding sheet. But the crown that he wore and the cross that he bore were his own. The cross was his own. That's the only consolation that's offered in this world. And frankly, it's the only consolation you'll ever need.